And now, just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord,
you must continue to follow him.
Let your roots grow down into him, and let your lives be built on him.
Then your faith will grow strong in the truth you are taught, and you will overflow with thankfulness.
Don't let anyone capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense that come from human thinking and from the spiritual powers of this world rather than from Christ.
For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body.
And you have been filled in him.
Who is the head of all rule and authority?
Well, all right. Good morning, church. Morning. Man, that was some good songs there. I just love that song. I could lay my head. I don't know. What is it called? What's the name of the song? Heart Won't Stop. Yeah, My Heart Won't Stop. I think about that song every time we do it, that probably, I know we've explained it several times, but sometimes we might not know, like, what Sheol is. It's like the deep pit, you know what I'm saying? Like, he says, I could lay my head in Sheol, like, it's, like, way down there. So no matter, like, where we go, like, he's still going to be chasing after us. Isn't that good news? Man, I'm just so glad that, you know, I think about that song sometimes throughout the week, and it's like, man, whenever I sin, right, I do, everybody does, whenever I fall short of the glory of God, it's like, man, I'm so grateful. Like, it's not, I don't want to sin, but whenever I do, man, I'm just so grateful that we worship a God that still loves us in the midst of that. Isn't that good news, man? I'm so grateful for his grace and mercy and forgiveness, man. It's good stuff. Hey, we're in week 3 of this series called Rooted. Say that with me. Rooted. All right. So today we're going to talk about being rooted in worship. Rooted in worship. And our series is based off of this passage in Colossians chapter 2. Take a look at it. This is what it says. It says, and now just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. What's it say? Let your roots grow down into him. And really catch this next part, because this is kind of what we're going to dive into today, okay? So it says, let your roots grow down into him. And look at this next part. And let your lives be built on him. Let your lives be built on him. Then your faith will grow strong in the truth that you were taught, and you will overflow with what? Thankfulness. Thankfulness. So we want to talk today in our series called Rooted. We want to talk about being built up in him. Being built up in him. Because something that is rooted and goes down deep, like, it's going to come up, right? It's going to be built like a tower, right? You're not going to build a tower with no foundation. Am I right? You're not going to have a tree that don't, you're not going to have a 50-foot tree that doesn't have roots going way deep, right? So anything that you see that is strong and built up, right, then it must have something that goes deep, right? So let your roots grow down into him and let your lives be built on him. So today we're going to be talking about being built in Jesus. Now, without raising your hands or anything, we want to worship Jesus with our entire lives, don't we? Like, we want to worship Jesus, like, day in, day out. If we say we love God, right, if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, Romans chapter 10, verse 9, and we want to worship him with our lives, right, we want that, right, as Christians, as disciples of Christ, we want that to be every day, don't we? Like, I highly doubt that there's anybody sitting in here this morning saying, no, like, I'm content. Like, God gave his very life for me, he's poured his blood out for me, he rose from the dead, and I'm perfectly content worshiping him for 1 hour on a Sunday, right? It's like, no, that doesn't make sense, does it? Like, if he gave his everything for you, we want to give our everything for him, don't we? So we want to talk today about worshiping Jesus with our entire lives. And here's kind of what this is going to look like. Take a look at Romans chapter 12 with me. So today we're going to talk about being rooted in worship. And I want to lay the foundation today that I believe that worship is not just songs, right? That's a part of worship, But that is not the only form of worship, right? So take a look at Romans chapter 12, verse 1. This is what it says. So Paul says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you." So Paul is building this case in the book of Romans about how they have they're given their lives for the gospel, Romans chapter 1, verse 16, that they're not ashamed of the gospel, right? That Adam came to give us an example, and then Jesus came to give us a better example. Then we learn in Romans chapter 6 what it looks like to give your life to Jesus in baptism by being buried with him and dying with him and being rose from the dead, right? That's the picture of baptism. So he continues in this case that he's building, and he says, give your bodies to God because of everything that he's done for you. Take a look at what it says next. It says, let them be what? A living and holy sacrifice. The kind that God will find acceptable. So let your lives be a living and holy sacrifice. I've heard it said several times that the problem with a living sacrifice is that it continues to crawl off the altar. Have you heard that before? Right? So we want to learn how to stay on the altar, right? We want to be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that God will find acceptable. This is truly the way, what? To worship him by being a living sacrifice. Now, what does it look like to be a living sacrifice? We're going to talk about that today, but it's all-encompassing, right? It means every ounce of you, every hair on your body, every thought that goes through your mind, we're going to take every thought captive. Like, everything about us is submitted to him, right? Paul continues. He says this. This is important. I think we, with the world that we live in today, this is such a good word. Take a look at this. Paul says, don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you. You want to know God's will for your life? Of course we do. Which is good and pleasing and perfect. So we're going to kind of build a case off of this passage today, and we're going to be in a lot of other passages today, but I think that we are going to be really blessed by what the Lord has laid on my heart this week. So I want to start with this idea that, let me take a seat back here real quick. I'm going to be talking primarily to people today that have already given their lives to Jesus. So if you have not given your life to Jesus and you have not been baptized, I think you're still going to be blessed today by this. But think primarily for those that have already given their lives to Jesus, okay? We grow to maturity, right, best if we are in relationship with others, right? And there's a reason for that. The goal that we call maturity is the consistent habit of loving God and loving others well, right? It's not simply knowing the Bible, right? Although that is really important. It really helps for us to have the word of Christ in our minds. It's not laboring on 5 church committees, although service, right? If done for the right reason, is a form of love. We don't want to serve reluctantly. But maturity is loving well and allowing others to love us well, too. That's spiritual maturity. With that in mind, I want to talk today about being rooted in worship, with our lives being a living and holy sacrifice. And I want to give us 5 character traits today that should be found in someone that is a mature disciple that worships Jesus daily, not just in song, not just in giving, not just in service, but all-encompassing. I want to give us 5 character traits of a mature disciple. And I believe that a mature disciple will display these traits in every sphere of their lives, meaning that they act and we act as mature disciples the same way at work, at home, in the world, and in our church, right? So number one, being a mature disciple starts with this. Speaking the truth in love. Will you say that with me? Speaks the truth in love. You know, immature believers and immature disciples can be very, very destructive to others when they don't have the kind of love that's described in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. God's love is a crucial component when we are declaring to a lost world that we have found what they're looking for. Without that, it won't take long for the world to see a disconnect between us and Him. Real faith in Christ, catch this, real faith in Christ leads to an understanding of God's heart to restore relationship with Him and with others. God's heart is to save and to rebuild. God will take a messy life and turn it into something beautiful. Do you have a testimony like that? God will take a wreck of a life or something that is seemingly beautiful and turn it into something even more beautiful. Right? So as we grow up and as we begin to know Him who is the way, the truth, and the life, and to love what He loves, ourself and others, I think that's a crucial part. Right? God loves you, right? So you should love yourself as well. And God loves others, so we should love others well. So take a look at what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. He says, if I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have what? Love. I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. You ever heard one of those? I think the drums were kind of turned down a little bit today, but if David were to get back up here and we crank that thing up and he just bangs on them cymbals, like, it's super annoying, isn't it? Right? You know what I mean? But that's what we look like as disciples or as people that call ourselves Christians if we slap this label on ourselves and we try to speak truth into this world, but we don't have love. That's exactly what you will sound like to other people. Right? That did not work as planned. But that's what we sound like whenever we speak words without love. Take a look again at what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4. Instead, speaking the truth how? In love, we will grow to become in every respect what? The mature body of Him. Paul's trying to get something across here. That we are to grow in maturity. And the way that we grow in maturity is that we grow in worship. We grow in love of God and of others. So what's he say? Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head. That is who? Jesus Christ. Right? And I want to stop just for a second real quick. I think that so oftentimes we can get so caught up in speaking the truth that we neglect love. And that's a dangerous spot to be. And I think on the opposite spectrum of that, we can get so caught up in speaking love that we neglect truth. I think for a mature disciple, we need to live in the tension between truth and love. There is a great tension there. And we need to live in that tension if we're going to be mature disciples of Christ. So the number one characteristic that we're going to base our worship of God on today is speaking the truth in love. Number two is this. Check this out. Is what? Others-centered. If we want to be a mature disciple of Christ, we need to be others-centered. Keep it there just for a second. As we grow up into our salvation, what I mean by that is at one point we were a babe in Christ, right? And what I mean by that is whenever we give our lives to Jesus in baptism, we are a baby in Christ, right? We're still drinking milk. We're not eating solid food yet. We can't understand the depths of God's love yet. We maybe understood grace for the first time and we gave our lives to Him. But at some point, we got to grow up into our salvation. Does that make sense? Hebrews would describe it like that, that at some point, we got to start eating steaks, right? We got to eat some steaks. So as we grow up into our salvation and we become mature disciples, we should move from self-centeredness to others-centeredness. We should grow from being a consumer, right, that somebody gave the gospel to you and you consumed it. We should grow from being a consumer to a contributor. Does that make sense? Not because we think less of ourselves. Like, I don't believe that that's what humility is. It's maybe thinking, not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less often, right? Not because we think less of ourselves, but because we are thinking of ourselves less often. Immature believers tend to use words like this. I, me, myself. They use words like that a lot. Immature believers are going to talk about themselves. They're going to talk about themselves a lot. As in, they'll say stuff like this. This is something that an immature disciple would say. And it's okay if you have caught yourself saying these types of things. It's okay, but just know God, in his love and grace and mercy, is going to bring you up out of this. And that's good news. You got to start somewhere, but God's going to bring you up out of this. So these are the kinds of things that an immature disciple would say. Well, I didn't like the worship music today. Right? You ever heard somebody say that? I didn't like the worship today. Well, that's okay. We weren't worshiping you. Well, I didn't like the preaching today. That's okay. Somebody did. They didn't welcome me at church today. Right? I don't love my spouse the way that I used to. My friendship isn't meeting my needs. These are the kinds of things that an immature disciple will say. These types of statements are saying that the world revolves around who? Me. Others exist for me. This is a far cry from what real love would say. We need to grow up out of these types of attitudes. We need to move from being self-centered to others-centered. Take a look at Philippians chapter 2. This is what it says. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, what does Paul say? In humility, value others above yourselves. Notice what Paul just said. Move from being self-centered to other-centered. In humility, value others above yourself. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. So this is number two on what we will look for in a mature disciple that worships Jesus, not one day a week, but every day of their life. They will be an others-centered person. So that's number two. Number three is this. You ready for this? This one's tough. It's tough for me. It's tough for a lot of people, right? But take a look at this. Read it with me. Forgives and does not take offense. Oof, right? That one will punch you in the gut. You know what I'm saying? Like whenever Jesus says if somebody slaps you on one side, what are we supposed to do? Turn and let them slap the other side. I have a funny story about that. My wife didn't really care for this all that much. So this week, we're at home and we're standing in our kitchen. And my 2-year-old, almost 3-year-old son walks up to my 5-year-old, almost 6-year-old daughter. And he walks up to her and goes, wham! And I'm like, ah. Caitlin was not too happy about it, but me being a preacher, this is what I said. Afton, turn your other cheek. What, Daddy? Well, if you turn your other cheek and let him hit the other side too, he'll probably stop because he'll feel guilty. Isn't it funny how that works? Forgives and does not take offense. You see, when others fail us, and they will, right? People will fail us. I will fail you. You will fail me. We will fail each other. We will fall short together. We will fall short alone. But when others fail us, real love, the love that we learn about in here, offers grace and does not get offended. Maintaining this type of attitude, the kind of love that we learn about there, hinges on having the correct perspective. Seeing things maybe through the other person's eyes and having true empathy makes it easier to overlook an offense. This is one of the things that my wife tells me all the time. Blade, you have a lot of sympathy, you just don't have empathy. And it's true. I'm still growing in that perspective. Often, though, when people know that sin has hurt their relationships, they're really afraid to ever trust again. Yet Paul's definition of love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 tells us that love keeps no record of wrongs. We want to grow up into that, don't we? Because I don't know about you, God's still got a lot of work to do on me, because every once in a while I'll keep a record. I don't like it. I don't like that my mind does that and I try to take every thought captive, but it's true. And I'm sure that it's true for you as well. But Paul tells us that God's definition of love keeps no record of wrongs. In other words, it forgives. It also tells us that love endures all things. And if we're going to move out of self-centeredness to others-centeredness, and we're going to learn how to forgive and not take offense, we need to learn how to endure all things. Things that make us uncomfortable, things that we don't like, whenever others sin against us, we need to learn how to endure, because our faith does not rest in others, it rests in Him. So although somebody might have hurt you, somebody might have sinned against you, and it's really difficult to forgive, we need to grow up into that. It's hard, takes a lot of practice, takes a lot of taking your thoughts captive and submitting them to Jesus. It also tells us, well, it tells us that love endures all things, and it keeps trying to make the relationship work. At the same time, though, this is also true. We may need to distance ourselves from an unhealthy relationship with someone who refuses to receive forgiveness, or someone who refuses to get help. You know what I'm talking about. We do this to draw a boundary for their own good. It shouldn't leave us stuck with the fear of ever trusting anyone again. But listen to this. Not being forgiving makes us run the risk of becoming bitter. And bitterness will destroy your life. That's why I think that God knows what He was talking about. Although it's really, really, really hard whenever somebody hurts you, somebody sins against you, or the worst one that I think about is somebody just walks out of your life and never says anything. And you're stuck with the thoughts of trying to figure out what it is. We need to forgive anyway. Take a look at Paul, what he says again in Colossians. This is what he says. Make allowance for what? Each other's faults. Make allowance for each other's sins. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. We fail every single day. Make allowances for other people's faults. And forgive anyone who offends you. Why? Remember, the Lord forgave us, so we must forgive others. It's hard, but whenever we understand the magnitude of God's forgiveness for us, that's when we can bear fruit of forgiveness for others. Take a look also at Proverbs. Like I said, every time I read Proverbs, if you like Twitter and you like little golden nuggets of things, you would love the book of Proverbs. This is what Proverbs chapter 19 says. A person's wisdom yields patience. It is to one's glory to to overlook an offense. It will do us well, God says. It'll put a crown of glory on our heads to overlook an offense. So that one's tough. So the number three characteristic of a mature disciple is someone who forgives and does not take offense. Here's number four. You ready for it? This one's really good. Is humble. Let me keep going. You want to read the next part? Is humble and submits to authority. There's a book I read not too long ago by Jim Putman called The Power of Together. And he talks about a gentleman he met who had been going, that had been through seven churches in a matter of about 4 years. He believed that God had given him the gift of teaching. And if a church did not allow him to teach, he would never stay. And if he did teach, and anyone didn't agree with every single opinion that he had, he also wouldn't stay. When asked what the conflict had been, he explained that in every case, he believed that he was in the right, and those who disagreed with him either didn't have his level of education or the humility to learn from him. He and his wife bounced from church to church to church to church, disagreeing with every single leadership over minor issues, and he displayed no desire to commit to a church or to submit to the authority of its leaders. When I speak with someone that refuses to place themselves under the authority of men, good men, it is usually a good indication that they are not under God's authority either. When Jesus came to this earth, he gave up all of his authority and humbled himself. Humble people, catch this, humble people do not assume that they know everything. Let me say that again. Humble people do not assume that they know everything. They are usually ready and willing to learn from those around them. I call these people lifelong learners. And this attitude, somebody that's humble and willing to learn from those around them, is one of the things that we will look for as a characteristic of spiritual maturity. Take a look again at what Paul says. Paul was such a leadership guru, huh? Look at Philippians chapter 2. This is what it says. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God. Catch that. He's the creator of everything. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, what did he do? He gave up his divine privileges and he took the humble position of a slave. If anybody models humility for us, it is Jesus. Take a look also at Ephesians chapter 5. And further, submit to one another. Not because you always agree with one another. Why do we submit to one another? Out of reverence for Christ. Because he modeled it for us. So number four in characteristics of a mature disciple that worships Jesus daily, is learning from him daily, is gathering grace and forgiveness daily, is that they're humble and that they submit to authority. Here's a big one, and here's the last one that I want to talk about today. This one is big. is able to feed himself or herself. In the physical world, it's a big step when a child can begin to feed themselves, isn't it? I remember that first time that my kids picked up a spoon and scooped it on a plate and put it into their mouth. It didn't look pretty. They were probably holding it like this, but they did it. And oftentimes, that's what it looks like whenever we try to feed ourselves for the first time. We're like, heck, I don't know how to feed myself. What's this say? Paul, a servant? Okay. But it's a good step. Doesn't always look pretty, but it's a good step. In the physical world, it's a big step when a child can begin to feed themselves rather than passively being fed. It's the same way in spiritual growth. As we mature and as we grow up into our salvation, we're not a babe in Christ anymore. We move from being consumers to contributors. As mature disciples, we will no longer expect weekend services or even our life group alone to feed us, because we will feed ourselves every day, or we will die. We're learning to feed ourselves through time alone with Jesus each day. And God's given us several ways to grow and mature in our journey with him. First, we have a model to study. His name is Jesus. Learn about Jesus in the way that he spent his time. He spent his time with others. He spent his time in prayer. He spent his time working. He was a carpenter. We have a good model to study. We have Jesus. We can treat him as our ultimate role model, I guess you could say. Second, we have the Word of God as the Holy Spirit-inspired roadmap that tells us where to go and how to get there. Third, we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us. That's a big one, that we will never quite understand the depths of this until we have the Holy Spirit guiding us. He empowers us to live out what we have learned. He empowers us to forgive and to love and to show grace. But lastly, we have the Holy Spirit working through others around us. Not only is he alive in you, he's alive in the neighbor you're sitting next to. So as we feed ourselves with the Word of God, we become well nourished and are able to take the responsibility to feed others. You know, in the Old Testament, God blessed a man named Abraham. He looked at Abraham and he said, Abraham, you're going to be the blessing of the world, right? Your descendants are going to be as numerous as the sand on the seashore and as the stars in the sky. So what does God do? God blesses Abraham. He blesses him spiritually. He blesses him financially. He gives him all kinds of cattle and sheep and land and all this kinds of stuff. He blesses Abraham and his family, and he does all these kinds of things. And it would have been so easy for Abraham to take that blessing and keep it to himself. And I would submit to us today that the purpose of a blessing is never for you alone. If you look at the word blessing in all of Scripture, what you're going to see is the same thread, that God blesses so that they can bless. It's multiplication, right? It's not consumption, it's multiplication. God blesses so that we can bless. So whenever we are feeding ourselves with the Word, it should never, never, never be for us alone. This is what John chapter 15 says. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine. And you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. So as mature disciples of Christ, we will learn to feed ourselves. Obviously, though, this is not an exhaustive list, but I think that everything else branches off of these. Becoming more like Jesus is the target of spiritual maturity. It's the target of worship. So we're not going to sit down and list all of the characteristics, but I think this is a good start. But if you know someone whose life consistently exhibits what we just talked about, it's a really, really good indicator of their relationship with God as a life of a disciple. So one more time, a mature disciple speaks the truth in love, is others-centered, forgives and does not take offense, is humble and submits to authority, and is able to feed themselves. So with that being said, I don't know how God is speaking to your heart today, but I'm sure he is because he's alive and active. He penetrates soul and spirit. He can separate bone from marrow, right? I don't know how God's speaking to your heart today, but I believe that all of us need to work on all of this. As we grow up into our salvation and we seek to worship Jesus daily as a disciple, we learn from him and we grow closer to him so that we can reach a lost and broken world. You may not know this now, but someday, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, maybe 20 years from now, somebody is going to depend on you. You're going to share the gospel with somebody and they will have never heard it before. So start growing in maturity and in worship now. Because somebody's life, somebody's eternity hangs in the balance. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful that we have this time to gather together to talk about a topic of maturity and of worship, God, that is not always comfortable, but it's needed. God, I pray that you will help grow us through the power of your Holy Spirit, that you will help us seek to grow closer to you every day through these five characteristics, God, that we might grow closer, that we might be a blessing to others. We love you, Jesus, with our whole heart, with our whole being, every ounce of who we are. In Jesus' name, amen.